Welcome to the 2016 Vienna Goethe Lectures of the Faculty of Informatics of TU Wien. My name is Stefan Seider. I'm professor here in computer science, and I'm your host this evening. And it will be a great pleasure for me to introduce our today's speaker. But before that, we have two welcome addresses. First from our Vice Rector for Research, Professor Johannes Fröhlich, followed by a welcome address from our Dean of Informatics, Professor Hannes Werdner. So, Professor Fröhlich, please.
Dear colleagues, welcome here at the Getreidemarkt campus. It's the first time, I guess, the lecture is here. Usually it was in the Electrical Engineering Faculty, so this gives me the chance to have a short visit at my home base, because you might know I'm a chemist, so this is the chemistry and mechanical engineering campus here, and also I'm located at Karlsbad, but it's not too often that I come here, because there is too much work, and I'm, so to say, too much in my prison, in my office at Karlsbad, and have no chances to go here. So this time, thanks to this lecture, I have a chance to get a few minutes here. It's a very nice occasion, because it's the Goethe Lecture, a very renowned lecture series, I dare say, because it's already the fourth of these lectures. It was started with Gerald Steinhardt a few years ago, 2013, with Donald Knuth, who was the first lecturer here. Then we had one of the youngest professors of computer science, Eric Demain, in 2014. Last year, a big company was represented, Google Research, with Peter Norvig, and this time we have another big company represented here. And what I appreciate very much, the first time with an IT woman here, so this is the first, the fourth, so we needed four trials, but now we have managed to get a high-ranking IT woman here, Jeanette Wink. I do hope you also agree that you are on a IT well-paved ground here, because the Faculty of Informatics is one of the strongest faculties in Europe. We are very proud when we look to various rankings that informatics is always one of the top faculties of our university. This is due to a good strategy that has been conceived and has followed over the years. And it's insofar important as ICT is not only very important at our university, but it's also something, a discipline that is very, also important today in a lot of cross-media related research themes. So if you look to topics like Industry 4.0, Internet of Things, all these issues were sort of interconnecting knowledge is required. It's very important today to have this ICT knowledge and also new developments available. So with this regard and for this sake, we do hope that the faculty develops more and more and better. I think the signs are very positive here, because all the appointments of professors within last time, and also the strategies in the development plan of informatics are very heading towards new frontiers. And so we are also, of course, very interested in the topic of today's lecture, computational thinking, something which is a real topic of the future. We all daily hopefully think, and so in the future we hopefully can also underpin this by computational, so to say, aids and help. And this is something where I think all the things, we intelligence of the future and all these issues will be covered. So I will have a few minutes, maybe some 20 minutes, to follow your lecture. I then have to leave, unfortunately, for another appointment, but that's the reason why I close already now, so that all the opening words are short, so that I can attend as long as possible to your lecture. Welcome, and welcome also to you.
Welcome also from my side to the audience, and welcome to Jeanette Wink. We are very honored that you give today this Goethe lecture. And also thank you to Johannes Fröhlich for his very encouraging congratulations on our strategy. And we hope that we can continue and reflect and on your support. We are very honored that you give the Gödel lecture today. But you not only do this, but you also had a meeting already. We had an internal meeting with female researcher, which was organized by Gerti Kappel, and where you participated, discussing, let's say, supporting female researchers as well as students. And this is also part of our overall strategy of the faculty, where we really want to support female researchers. To the Gödel lecture, already said by Johannes, that it's now for the fourth year. And what do we really aim at? No, we really aim at to reflect on the contribution of computer science. State also that computer science is a core science of today's society. It's expressed by we are living in the information age, in the digital age, in the information society, in the computer society. And computer science, or informatics, as we say here in Austria, has really developed to one of the core pillars of this development. Also, we are a very young society, a young science. The contributions we are inviting, the speakers we are inviting, they directly or indirectly reflect on this development, and they reflect on two sides of computer science. One is the formative, constructive side, where we shape and change the world. Just look around where all we have these mobile devices, the different software and hardware artifacts we are dependent on already. But it's also a reflection on the how we see the world, how we experience it, how we have the interpretation, and thus also how we conceptualize the world. So the thinking, how our thinking is influenced by this algorithmic approach, by the formal approach. And this fits very well with the title. This overall aim fits very well with your title of your today's speech. And we are very grateful that you do this. I just want to have a final note that you also somehow argue for fundamental research, basic research, which you also did in front of the American Senate, underlining the importance of basic research, not only for the research itself, but also for development of our society, innovation, and industrial applications, where it fits together, and it somehow, as a personal note, it makes it sometimes difficult to differentiate between applied and fundamental research, and I think you can follow up on that, coming from Microsoft being responsible for the research there. So thanks again for being with us, and I give it back to Stefan to introduce Shani Twing. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a great pleasure to introduce our today's speaker, Shani Twing. I guess I could speak for an hour to list all her achievements, all what she did, but I tried to be short and maybe highlight just some aspects of her really outstanding career. First, Shani Twing is a renowned researcher in the formal methods field, where she has made influential work on specification, verification of computer systems, and she is still active in this area. I think her recent research interests are on privacy issues and security issues of computing systems and computer networks. But there is also Shani Twing, who directs high-profile research institutions. For instance, currently she is the corporate vice president of Microsoft Research, where she is in charge of all the core research laboratories of Microsoft all over the world. Before that, she was directing the computer science division of the National Science Foundation in the US. Before that, she was the head of the computer science department at Carnegie Mellon University, where she still holds an adjunct professorship. Another facet of her activities was just mentioned by our dean, is her strong support for basic research. And she gave this statement to the US Senate just a couple of weeks ago, where she pointed out the importance of adequate funding for basic research, which she pointed out makes also sense just from an economic point of view, because it increases the growth of the economy. Okay, and now, last not least, now already moving towards the topic of today's talk, Jeanette has been engaged in questions of computer science education, curricula, and also education in general. And she is a strong promoter of this, this concept of computational thinking, which is the topic also of her talk today. And computational thinking is something that is not only relevant for computer scientists, but I think for everybody. And I think there was just the 10th anniversary of her article in the communication of the ACM, which really kind of pushed forward this whole idea of computational thinking and made people consider it also for really introducing these concepts into curricula. So I don't want to delay the talk anymore and I stop here, and please join me welcoming Jeanette Wing.
Okay. So thank you very much for hosting me. It's a pleasure for me to be in Vienna and to visit this university, my first time visiting the university, but not my first time visiting Vienna. I am going to talk about computational thinking. I want to thank all the people who introduced me in all sorts of ways. That was really quite special. It must be an Austrian tradition. Normally, they just sort of say your name, your title, and you're up there. So thank you very much. I'm going to remember this. Okay, so my grand vision, and I stated this, in fact, 10 years ago, is that computational thinking will be a fundamental skill used by everyone by the middle of the 21st century. By fundamental, I mean as fundamental as reading, writing, and arithmetic. So it's a grand vision, and it's a bold vision, and you're going to help me achieve it. Of course, it will be computing and computers that will spread computational thinking. And already, I believe that this vision is coming true in all disciplines of science and engineering, in the research enterprise and the way in which science and engineering research is conducted. I say that with authority because when I was at the National Science Foundation, we started programs specifically computational thinking for science and engineering, and that was already around 2007, 2008. And it's just a given. So for those of you, well, many of you are in computer science, but for those of you who are graduate students in other disciplines, in other science and engineering disciplines, I am sure you use computation in some way in your own research endeavors. So that's a given for science and engineering. But my vision is bolder than computational thinking for research for science and engineers. It's for all disciplines. Historians, artists, humanities, social scientists, economists, politicians even. So I'm going to make an argument later about how computational thinking is influencing all disciplines. Now this vision of mine with the implication on research also has an implication on education. And 10 years ago, I foresaw that certainly at the graduate level and even at the college level, computing would be prevalent on campuses, as prevalent as computer science courses, introduction to computer science courses, would be taught for non-majors, for people who are not majoring in computer science. And non-majors will flock to these courses because they will want to learn computer science concepts to take them wherever they go, whatever profession they pursue, whatever major they are in. And this is happening across the United States and other countries as I speak. What I didn't anticipate at all is what is happening now in the K-12 space. And by K-12 in the United States, that means kindergarten, which is when you're about 5 years old, to 12th grade, which is when you're about 18 years old. So I believe here in Austria, you call that school. So computing at school, just as in the UK, they call that school. So when I talk about K-12, I mean school-age children. What I didn't anticipate 10 years ago is that computational thinking would become pervasive in K-12 education. And I will speak at the end of my talk about some of the efforts that are going on throughout the world in that space. I wrote this 3-page article 10 years ago. It's very easy to read. I encourage all of you to read it. It's very easy to understand. It's a little poetic now that I read it again. It's one of those articles you can read just before you go to bed at night, so it's very light reading. So, what is computational thinking? And I give this definition specifically to a computer science audience because the words I use in this definition have technical meaning from a computer science perspective. So, to a non-computer science audience, I usually say computational thinking is thinking like a computer scientist, which is not helpful at all to a non-computer science audience. But since you're mostly computer scientists, I'll give you this definition. Computational thinking is the thought processes, and this is very important. People think. So computational thinking are the thought processes done by humans, involved in formulating a problem and expressing its solutions in such a way that a computer, and this is critical, a computer can be a human. Humans compute. A computer, of course, can be a machine. But more interestingly, today, we have networks of humans and machines working together to solve problems that neither can solve alone. So that's another kind of computer. In such a way that a computer can effectively carry out. Effectively is critical here, because in computer science, we only care about those problems that we can effectively solve. Expressing is also critical here, because that brings in all the work that we do in programming languages and specification, verification, and so on. So in a nutshell, computational thinking adds to the repertoire of problem-solving skills. That's, in a nutshell, what computational thinking is all about. Now, I'm very careful to, in my little 3-page article, to say more than problem solving, because that tends to sound like mathematics. I also say system design, because computer scientists design and build systems as well as solve problems. So I want to make sure that all of computing is covered. The critical thought process in computer science is abstraction. We all know that. And computer science, to me, is simply the automation of abstractions. Abstractions, of course, are not unique to computer science. Oops. Mathematics invents abstractions, reasons about abstractions, and so do all science and engineering disciplines. They call them models or abstractions, theories. But what's different about computer science is that we take those abstractions and we make them come alive. We get the machine, usually, to operationalize those abstractions so we can simulate behavior, so we can reason about behavior, and so we can predict other behavior. Moreover, these abstractions that we invent are usually fairly complex. So just think about internet protocols that are stacked on top of each other, that move the bits around the world. Without those layers of abstraction that is our internet, we wouldn't probably be here today. So it's amazing that in computer science, we can build very complex systems like the internet, which are really just zeros and ones moving around the world without even thinking that there's zeros and ones down there. Computational thinking philosophically complements and combines mathematical and engineering thinking. Computational thinking draws on mathematics as its foundations because computer science foundationally is based in mathematics, whether it's logic or discrete math, and so on. So of course computer science draws on mathematics as its foundations, but there's a difference. In computer science, we care a lot about the boundary conditions. We often operate in terms of finite domains. And so we have to worry about the edge conditions. In fact, that's where we usually get into trouble, when we forget to. We are constrained, in the end, by the physics of the machine. Whether it's, you know, how many floating point numbers you can represent in whatever byte addressable machine you have, how much storage you have, what the processing capability is, what the power efficiency is of that machine. And similarly, even with the human, you know, we are limited by our own physical constraints. We don't know what they are, but we know we're limited by them. Computational thinking draws on engineering thinking because our systems, the systems that we build in computing, interact with the real world. So any digital device that you have, that your phone, the ATM machine, cash registers today, they're all digital. They interact with the real world. Whether it's the physical infrastructure here, my guess is that these lights go off when no one's in the room, or interacting with human beings. However, in computer science, we have one special secret weapon that no other engineering discipline has. It's what distinguishes computer science from other engineering disciplines. What is that? What is that secret weapon? What?
Simulation?
No. It's software. In software, you can build anything. Software allows us to build virtual worlds, and in a virtual world, you can defy the laws of physics. You can defy the laws of nature. You are only limited by your own creativity. In software, you can build anything. And so there's a bit of mathematical thinking and a bit of engineering thinking and computational thinking, but computer science is different from other engineering disciplines and from mathematics. It's something special. And that's why I like to think that thinking computationally adds something to your thinking skills, to your problem-solving skills. What I'm going to talk about is not the artifacts, the hardware and the software that we create as computer scientists. But I'm going to talk about the concepts, the ideas in computer science, be they algorithms or data structures or simply concepts that we learn in system design. And I do believe that computational thinking is for everyone, everywhere. Just to be concrete, because abstractions are fairly abstract, here's an example of the kinds of abstractions that we know and love in computer science. And I think you'll recognize your own research area there, I hope. and for the students, you'll recognize classes that you took on these topics. I'm not saying that everyone needs to learn all those abstractions. I'm saying that there are some abstractions that everyone can learn and benefit from learning. What an algorithm is, for instance, what a state machine is. But the main reason I'm showing you this list of concepts is to distinguish computational thinking from computer literacy. So when I say everyone in the world needs to learn computational thinking, I'm not saying everyone in the world needs to learn Word and Excel and PowerPoint. You're going to learn that anyway. And anyway, in a few years, maybe there'll be some other new technology to learn. So it's not about learning technologies, which come and go. It's computational thinking I also want to distinguish from computer programming. Of course, as a computer scientist, you learn how to program. Just like as a mathematician, you learn how to prove theorems. But computer science is much more than computer programming. And I think for this audience, I don't need to belabor that. So now what I want to do is spend a few minutes arguing that computational thinking has already influenced many, many, many other disciplines. And let me start with one discipline that's been influenced by many different computational methods. So, what one discipline might I have in mind? You can say anything. But what am I thinking of? Biology, who said that? Gold star. Thank you. So, okay. What was the big event in biology that made the biologist stand up and say, hey, you computer scientists, you might know something that can help me as a biologist? Yes, thank you. So I believe it was the shotgun algorithm that expedited the sequencing of the DNA genome that changed the attitude of biologists towards computing. That computing wasn't just a bunch of machines that did things quickly, but it also had ways of thinking, ways of encoding certain processes called algorithms that actually changed the way they discovered new biology. And many of these other techniques that I put in red are off-the-shelf computer science models, languages, tools, and so on. Many of these have been used to make new discoveries in biology. This list is already pretty old. But what's common to these computational techniques is that they are all ways of representing the dynamics of biological processes, much like we represent the dynamics of processes in computing, be they operating systems or distributed systems and concurrent processes and so on. So it's no wonder that our bread and butter models and tools and languages and techniques are applicable to biology. And what I wanted to do is give you one example of how bread and butter computer science tools and techniques can be used and have been used in biology. And the example I give is from work done by a Microsoft researcher in Cambridge, actually, on stem cell prediction. How many of you might be familiar with this work? Oh, good. So now you'll learn something. So embryonic stem cells have two very important properties. One is that they are self-renewing, which means they divide indefinitely. And the second property is called pluripotency, which means given any stem cell, it can possibly turn into any adult cell. We don't know how that works, but we know that's what happens. And of course, biologists want to understand how that happens. So what's exciting about, of course, stem cells, one other fact it's interesting, just as an aside, is given an adult cell, we can reprogram an adult cell. That means a cell that's already been differentiated. We can reprogram an adult cell into a stem cell. That's pretty amazing, because from a stem cell, if we knew how to direct it to become a certain kind of adult cell, then we could program the cells to become liver tissue or skin or some other organ. So that's why understanding how stem cells divide indefinitely and are pluripotent is important. So that's the background. What we do know about stem cells is, and this is a mouse embryonic stem cell that I'm talking about. A stem cell will remain self-renewing or differentiate toward an adult cell depending on the signals that it receives. And there are three important signals that are relevant. It turns out that two out of these three signals are needed for retaining pluripotency. So this is the biologists know. So what we can do is we can measure the expression of key genes in a stem cell and then trigger the three signals to see how much interaction there is between pairs of genes, depending on the signals. And that gives us this heat map, which is used in biology. But this heat map in biology, to us as computer scientists, is simply a Boolean network. So we've got blue nodes that represent the genes, we've got black nodes that are the three signals, we've got black dotted lines that represent a positive interaction between two genes, and red dotted lines that represent an inhibitory reaction between two genes. It's just a Boolean network. And now that we've encoded the behavior of the stem cell, the heat map, in terms of a Boolean network, well then, it's push the button for computer scientists, especially someone like you. So what Sarah Jane Dunn and her colleagues did is they used Z3, which is a state-of-the-art constraint solver, also built at Microsoft Research, that utilizes satisfiability modulo theories, SMT solving, to synthesize only those Boolean networks that actually reflect observations done in the lab. So there are, this particular Boolean network represents 10 to the 43 possible Boolean networks, and that's way too many for even our machines to process one at a time. But with constraint solving, we can pare down that number to only the ones that we care about. And the constraints are going to be defined by the observations through lab experiments. So what she was able to do was identify of the 10 to the 43 possible Boolean networks, the kernel Boolean network. This kernel Boolean network reflects every single experiment that has been done on stem cells has a behavior embedded in that Boolean network. So it basically, through Z3, she was able to cut out all the irrelevant Boolean networks. So this set was also used to make a large number, 53, of non-intuitive predictions of the response of the network to genetic perturbations. And these predictions were experimentally validated with over 70% accuracy rate, which is unheard of in biology, that high accuracy rate. So this is truly new biology discovered once you model the problem in a way that our off-the-shelf computer science tools can handle easily. So that's one example of many, many examples. So that's one example, in fact, of what I was trying to argue, that one discipline, biology, has already been influenced by many computational methods and techniques, in this particular case, verification techniques. And I obviously picked verification because of my own background, my familiarity, and because of yours. But let's flip the question around. What one computational method has influenced many different disciplines? Who said that? That's what I'm looking for, but I want you to use a different buzzword. What kind of learning? Machine learning. Thank you very much. Silver star. Machine learning has transformed statistics. So for instance, at Carnegie Mellon University, many years ago already, at least 10, 15 years ago, a machine learning department was created. Believe it or not, probably the only machine learning department in the world was created from computer science faculty and statistics faculty. It's a core department in the School of Computer Science at Carnegie Mellon University. And they have a PhD program in machine learning. They have, you know, undergraduate courses in machine learning and so on. And so machine learning truly has transformed the field of statistics. So it's certainly already being used in the sciences. It's been used in astronomy to discover brown dwarfs and fossil galaxies. It's used in medicine for drug discovery and analyzing images. It's used in meteorology to predict tornado formation. It's used in the neurosciences for looking at many, many fMRI scans of your brain to determine, for instance, what part of your brain lights up when you read a verb versus a noun. Machine learning is used beyond the science and engineering disciplines. It's used in detecting fraud for credit card companies. It's used in supermarkets. I don't know about here, but in the United States, every time you scan your food and get a receipt from the supermarket, the supermarket is keeping track of everything you bought, and it prints out coupons relevant to the things that they think you would like to buy. Machine learning, of course, has been used in the financial industry for good or bad. Machine learning is what is behind all the reputation services and recommendation systems on Netflix and Amazon and so on. And machine learning is even used in sports to analyze videotapes, for instance, of the athletes, of how they perform, so that coaches can better train their athletes. And this is used by professional teams as well as college teams. So what I wanted to show you was an example of how, very recently, the advances in machine learning, specifically deep neural networks, has transformed the IT industry, specifically Microsoft, but all of our competitors. And this goes back to speech recognition. So speech recognition has been a speech synthesis has been an area of study in computer science for decades. And for many, many years, even before this chart, in the 80s, the agency at the United States called NIST used to run these competitions to get the competing teams that could recognize speech to do better and do better and do better. After a while, the best that these teams could do was about a 25-26% word error rate. That meant if I spoke a sentence, essentially every fourth word it would get wrong. That was hardly very usable as a speech recognizer. But you could see for many years, progress in speech recognition basically plateaued. People weren't getting much better. Until around 2009, when I was going to say all hell breaks loose, but but I'm being videotaped, and I guess I just said it. when deep neural networks were shown to be very useful in tasks like character recognition, object recognition, and of course speech recognition. And it was a paper circa 2011 by some colleagues at Microsoft Research and University of Toronto where they showed that they could get the word error rate to about 15%, which is much more acceptable, one in six or seven words. And now you can see 2011, it's dropped below 10%. So with this progress and these layers in these DNNs, it emboldened the computer science community and especially companies that put a lot into speech like Siri and Cortana and now with Amazon Echo. It emboldened these companies to really take this research idea and put it into practice. And what happened was, in Microsoft, it was in fact a demo that my predecessor Rick Rashid gave in China that was a real trigger for what happened at Microsoft in ensuing years. So Rick Rashid stood in front of an audience 10 times as large as this one, in China, Tianjin, China, in 2012. I was actually in the audience. I wasn't at Microsoft at the time, but I was a guest speaker. And he spoke in English, and that English was then transcribed into English text, which was then translated into Chinese text, which was then uttered by a synthesizer that spoke Chinese in his voice. And this happened from English to Chinese in real time with very few errors. And he spoke this little speech. He did practice it the night before. And the Chinese students in the audience were in tears. Why? Because what this suggested is that we now have the technology through hard work in speech recognition, in machine learning, in deep neural networks, and all the other technologies that go around this, to think that maybe we can break down the language barriers in the world. And so the idea of putting this speech recognition and translation system into Skype, which is a Microsoft service, speaks to that dream of breaking the language barriers in this world. And imagine being able to communicate with anyone. You speak your native language, it gets translated automatically in real time to the language of the recipient, and vice versa. And imagine that, because so much of today's strife in the world is due to miscommunication. Perhaps intentional misinterpretation. Okay, but that's another talk. Okay, so anyway, machine learning has truly transformed many disciplines, and it's already in the hands of commonplace technology. So what about other disciplines beyond the sciences, in the sciences and beyond? And I'll just go through this very quickly. Computational thinking actually has been used for making discoveries in chemistry for a long time. In physics, there are interesting applications. I'll just tell you one. that was given to me, a story that was given to me by Scott Aronson, a theoretical computer scientist at MIT who studies quantum computing. He heard my talk about computational thinking, and he was visiting me at the time I was at the National Science Foundation. He said, "Oh, Jeanette, I have a computational thinking story for you." I said, "Okay, tell me." And he said that he had been working with physicists on a kind of quantum computer that uses what's called Hamiltonians. And in this kind of quantum computer, you pose your problem in a kind of structure called a Hamiltonian. Think of it as a graph or some kind of structure. And then you transform it into another kind of Hamiltonian from which you can read off the solution. And it was known by the physicists that you can actually take these two Hamiltonians and kind of morph them into each other. There was a process by which you could do that. But what the physicists never asked, which is the question he asked, is how fast does this process converge? It's a standard computer science question, how fast does something happen? But the physicists had never asked that question. And of course, he, as a computer scientist, was very interested in knowing the answer because he thought that if he had that answer and it were polynomially fast, he might have a hint at the P equals NP problem. So that's what his motivation was. And it turns out that it goes polynomially quickly until this very small window where it is exponential. So he still has some work to do. In math, engineering, of course, many of you are familiar with the combination of using computers and humans to solve theorems, prove theorems that hadn't been solved before. And engineering, of course, has been using computer simulation for decades. In economics, I think what has been very interesting, especially as many IT companies have been relying on advertising as their business, economics has come to play an important role in computer science and vice versa. Computational thinking has been used in patent law and in healthcare, I already mentioned. There are lots and lots of projects around the world on digital archaeology. There are programs at major universities in the United States on digital journalism. And there are now programs and majors, for instance, at Stanford University in digital humanities. So computational thinking or computer science or computational X, it's a given now in almost every discipline in many universities. I thought I would give you two examples, one from social science and one from economics. So this is, again, these two stories are from researchers at Microsoft. We have researchers who study crowdsourcing from both a computer science point of view and an anthropological point of view. Of course, in computer science, we view crowdsourcing as simply a network of people interacting with each other. So we've got nodes and edges. As an anthropologist, an anthropologist would look at crowdsourcing to try to do qualitative studies to understand the variety of nodes and the meaning of the edges. So one study that this combination of a computer scientist and anthropologist did was to look at where the crowd is, map the crowd, and they studied crowd workers in the United States and the crowd workers in India. And they wanted to discover what was interesting about these crowd workers. What they discovered two interesting points, I feel, two interesting points. One is that crowd workers do not obey the theory of perfect competition. The theory of perfect competition is that there's equal pay for people doing the same task. That would be fair. But it turns out in, you know, using a Mechanical Turk and other kind of crowdsourcing platforms, two different people doing the same task might be paid differently. And so they found this prevalence of imperfect competition. The second interesting fact they found was a lot of times studies based on crowd workers, and these are computer science studies, assume crowd workers are independent. But that's also not true. What they found was a lot of crowd workers actually formed ad hoc networks and helped each other out. And there was not independence. So in fact, they, for the most part, debunked a lot of papers and studies out there where people would assume independence of crowd workers and then make some observations and conclusions. So it is in that spirit that having social scientists work with computer scientists to study this at things at scale about people and their behavior is interesting. This, of course, crowd working is just tip of the iceberg. What this really suggests is, what is the future of work? We have already seen Uberization, or the sharing economy, completely disrupt certain industries. And we're going to see more and more of that. And so one can ask, what does work look like for a worker in the future? And who are the workers, and what are they going to do? And who are the people who are not going to be able to have a job anymore? How do they change? What do they do? So another example I wanted to share with you is from economics. So this is an economist working in the area of surveys and polling. And I thought this was, well, this is more relevant in the United States this year than probably here in Austria. But this election that he analyzed, actually was predicting election results, was the 2012 election where Obama and Romney were campaigning against each other. The idea here is, normally when polling companies like the Gallup poll and other big polling companies take polls, what they do is they try to identify a representative sample of the population and then infer what the results would be based on that representative sample. Makes perfect sense. What he said is, you don't need a representative sample to get good predictions. In fact, what he showed is, in his non-representative sample link polling technique, he got better predictions than what Gallup did. So his non-representative sample of people were Xbox users. So I don't know how many of you are Xbox users, but the typical Xbox user is, I would guess, between 14 and 34, usually white and usually male. And so how do you imagine polling Xbox users and getting any sense of an accurate prediction of who's going to win, Obama or Romney? And what the idea behind non-representative polling is, that you take each person who's polled, all the Xbox users, and you basically pull apart their characteristics. So you have white, male, lives in New York, democratically inclined, and age, and went to college. And you do that for each person. And there are sufficient older, non-white women who live in Iowa in the big sampling that you can get statistically significant representation for any slice through that big soup of features. And that's actually how he was able to outdo the Gallup poll. So the raw data shows shows pretty bad prediction compared to pollster.com, which is that dotted line up there, and the thick dotted line up there. And you'll notice how the thick dotted line underestimated the final election count outcome, which is the dotted line. But using statistical machine learning, statistical techniques in machine learning, you can take the red line I just showed you before, and because of the features and how you combine them, you get actually a much better predictor of who's going to win, better than the official polling site, pollster.com. So this is an example of how non-representative polling actually outdoes the billion-dollar business that surveys and polling companies like Gallup do. Okay, so now let me turn to computational thinking in daily life, and then I'll segue into education. So here is me at the National Science Foundation, my second day at work, and I'm getting my coffee. So this is me, and I'm going to get my cup and put some milk in it, and then put some coffee in, put some sugar, get a lid, get a napkin, and then exit. So as a computer scientist, I look at this coffee station, and what do I think? What do you think? How inefficient, right? How inefficient. Moreover, if there's someone in your way, it's you're waiting to get your lid and he's just getting his cup. Bad. So what do I think? As a computer scientist, what do you think? Well, first of all, you think, I can do better, right? I can make it more efficient. I can make this coffee station more efficient. And I've given you enough time to mull over this picture, so let me just tell you that the soda machine and the coffee machine are bolted into the counter, so you can't move them. But what I think is pipelining. You can think of it in however you wish, but I thought pipelining. And so how can I affect a pipeline? And actually I was thinking, what are the minimum number of stations I need to move to affect a pipeline? Oh, and is that actually the most efficient pipeline? Forget it, you know. It's good enough. Now I've really given you enough time to think. What's the answer?
Send someone else.
All you do have to do is move the lids over, and then you have a pipeline or a very smooth path, no backtracking. And so I go to the clerk at the cafeteria and I tell him, oh, you just need to move the lids over here. You have a much more efficient coffee station. And he's looking at me, what is she talking about? That was just my second day at the National Science Foundation. Of course, I had much greater influence in computational thinking at NSF than that. So now what about education? So as I mentioned, I think there is a challenge. There's a research question in K-12 or school-level education. And the research question is, what is an effective way of learning computational thinking by K-12 students? And I'd like to break this down into two parts. One is, what concepts can students best learn when? And my analogy is to mathematics. By the time you're 5 years old and you enter kindergarten, you have a sense of number. You have a sense of greater than, for instance, and you probably know how to count and things like that. You may not know addition and subtraction or multiplication, but you have a sense of number. By the time you're 12 years old, you have enough mathematical sophistication and enough mathematical background to learn algebra. At least in the United States, it's typically when we teach, you probably teach it when you're like 9 years old here. But in the US, we teach algebra when children are about 12 years old. And by the time you're 18, you have enough mathematical sophistication and mathematical background to learn calculus. So somehow we have figured out in mathematics what the progression of concepts is that reflects both the natural progression in math, but also it reflects the maturity, mathematical maturity of a child as he or she grows up. So what's the analogy in, what's the analogous progression of concepts in computer science? I don't know. I don't think any of us really know. Like, when's the right time, what's the right age to teach recursion? When was the first time you learned recursion? Did it come easy to you? Okay, here's another question. When we teach long division to 9-year-olds in the US, long division, the way we teach long division to 9-year-olds, it's just an algorithm. It's dividing one number into another, getting a quotient and a remainder. And we just give instance after instance to the 9-year-old to go home and do instance after instance to get that algorithm in his or her head. But we never utter the word algorithm. Why not? Don't you think that if we did, we would empower the child to think beyond just doing instance after instance of a long division algorithm? Maybe the child would discover a new algorithm, a different algorithm to do long division. Or maybe the concept of an algorithm is too abstract for a 9-year-old. I don't know. I'm a computer scientist. I'm not a learning scientist. I'm not an education scientist. So I do think that computer scientists, like mathematicians, have to work with education scientists and learning scientists and cognitive scientists and so on to figure out an answer to that question. And the second part of this question is, we also have the machine. And so we should also be asking, how can we best integrate the use of this machine into the learning of these concepts? Because I don't think throwing hardware and software onto the laps of 9-year-olds necessarily is the best way to teach computational thinking. And what we see often in classrooms is a lot of technology and the use of that technology, but not a lot of teaching of the concepts. So I'd like to see more of the teaching of the concepts and less here's how to use the technology, because technology changes. So I do think computer scientists should be working with educators and learning scientists to answer these kinds of questions. What is so rewarding and gratifying is that there are, despite our not knowing the answer to those research questions, there are many movements across the world, in the United States and the UK especially, on getting computational thinking into K through 12 curricula. There's a whole movement now to change the advanced placement college course so that high school students can place out of that college course by taking the advanced placement course in high school. There are teaching materials that the Computer Science Teachers Association has put up on the website that helps teachers and students learn computational thinking. Code.org is an organization that Microsoft helps fund, which is to promote the vision that every high school student in the United States should have access to a computer science course. And Congress has even gotten involved in promoting Computer Science Week. What I'm most impressed with is President Obama, in this year's State of the Union address, said, in the coming years, we should build on that progress by providing pre-K for all, offering every student the hands-on computer science and math classes that make them job-ready on day one. He's essentially saying that the future workforce is going to need these computing skills, and so we should be getting them ready now. In Many metropolitan areas like Chicago and San Francisco, Washington State and New York City, computer science for all is becoming more of a mandate. So for instance, high school graduation requirement by 2018 in Chicago, this article, Computer Science for All Within 10 Years, was written last year in San Francisco, pre-K through high school, mandatory through eighth grade. That was also, I think, appeared last year. And then Washington State isn't quite there yet, or neither is Seattle, but there's a lot of support for K through 12 computer science education. And Microsoft has put some money behind this. So Microsoft is investing $75 million in computer science education. And I don't think I have a slide on this, but the National Science Foundation is putting hundreds of millions of dollars to support this, the president's initiative. So this is real. And I believe it's happening in other countries. In the United Kingdom, I actually praise the UK for being the leader in this. In 2012, they wrote the British Royal Society wrote a report called Shut Down or Restart. And it essentially says that computational thinking should be taught at every level in school, school being K through 12. And by September 2014, in England, an entirely new K through 12 subject called computer science was required by every student. So they're already far behind, far ahead of everyone in the world, including the US. And Microsoft has worked with the BBC just recently to put in the hands of a million year seven students and teachers a little device called the Microbit. It's about this big, and you can program it, you can have Microbits communicate with each other, and you can basically learn computing using this little device. And children have found it delightful. China is a little behind, but there are major efforts, and of course when China does something, China moves, you know, a billion people at once. So it's always a country to watch. So my three-page article was translated into Chinese and French, Korean and Japanese. It hasn't been translated into German yet, so maybe someone can do that. And so it is really I want to close by just saying, help me spread the word, help make computational thinking commonplace. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have time for a few questions.
Yes?
Your example from the US and the United Kingdom.
So what do they actually teach in the subject computer science in K-12?
So you would have to look, they have, in the UK, they actually have the curriculum spelled out per level, so you'd have to look at it. But it's appropriate for the age level. So they're not teaching, program verification to six-year-olds. They probably don't teach it to 18-year-olds either. there's another website that many of you I think might be familiar with called CS Unplugged. CS Unplugged was invented by Ball in New Zealand, and it's teaching young children, like four-year-olds to say 6 or 7-year-olds, computational thinking, computer science concepts without using a computer. And it's pretty effective, basically, for teaching a sorting algorithm. He has the children line up and they're unsorted, and then he has them move in exactly the ways that would then get them sorted, so they viscerally feel how that sorting algorithm works. So I don't know the specifics, but they're online. The curricula are online. Yes?
I have two questions. So one, the easiest one. So what was the secret to get more pay for the same task? Did you found out from the... Because you said that there was this study done in the States and India, and they found out the unfair payment. So what was the secret of the guys that got paid more?
What was the secret?
Yeah.
There was no secret. It was, I mean, it's not... Probably it's not surprising, right, that, you know, all this crowdsourcing effort really is about targeting different populations and incentivizing different populations to do certain pieces of tasks. So, of course, you're going to get a differentiation across different populations for different tasks, you know.
And the more serious question. So you are talking about deep neural networks, and the interesting thing is that networks, you can think of them also as analog computing, because a neuron essentially has a continuous switch. And I was wondering, I mean, there is also effort to build neural networks in analog devices, in discrete devices. I was wondering whether there are some efforts at Microsoft also in this direction.
Where there are no efforts to build an analog neural network, as you're suggesting. You know, I've always felt like that neural networks really are a metaphor for how our brain actually processes information. It's a very compelling metaphor, and it's no wonder that there are huge efforts. I think there's one huge effort here in Europe to build such a machine. And I think it'll be interesting to see what comes of that, whether it's truly just a metaphor, or whether there's something more than that.
You brought a list of where computer science influenced other sciences. Isn't there a chapter where computer science is influenced by other science? For example, biology, there are huge sets of procedures in optimization and things like that. So could you elaborate on
that?
Well,
I think the easiest, actually, for me to just go back to what I was alluding to earlier, is I actually think the economists have influenced the computer scientists more than the other way around. Partly this is due to how certain companies business model is based on advertising and how, again, it's about pricing, it's about incentives and rewards, and looking at econometric models to understand better human behavior so that you can exploit human behavior to make money off of that. Let's just put it bluntly, IT companies have chief economists working for them. You have a question?
Just following up just what you just said, you mentioned that computer science actually influenced statistics, and it had a big influence on statistics. But do you think that maybe statistics can at some point kind of sort of take a revenge?
Revenge.
Yes, so influence the computer science in a bigger way. Because you just said that econometric models, and I'm also, my background was in computer science and then in economics. So I came from economics back to computer science because I saw the connection, and the connection was very strong.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I was wondering your opinion on statistics and
computer science. I think in general, science and knowledge advance when different disciplines collaborate and work together. I think that you know, I always look for new research problems by looking at the intersection of different areas, for instance, computer science and economics. So that's the nature of discovery, that techniques from one field might be able to be applied to problems of another field. And then you have this feedback. The ways in which you solve that problem in another field suggest the limitations in the techniques, and so you advance the original field, and vice versa. And I think this is really the how our knowledge and our understanding of the world advances in general. So what I'm really trying to be is diplomatic, to say it's not like computer science influences every other discipline and it doesn't go the other way. Of course it goes the other way. Maybe not now, or maybe it has already, and maybe eventually will.
Well, the point probably is that we should be open-minded.
Yes, absolutely.
Combining different disciplines.
That's right. Yes. That's right.
Do you have any idea where to find the teachers to teach the CS concept?
This is an excellent question. The biggest obstacle we have today is we don't have enough teachers trained to teach computer science. I don't think this is an insurmountable obstacle. It's just the startup phase. But it is an important problem. And so what in the UK and the US is happening is there are a lot of teacher training programs. And I believe some of the money that the National Science Foundation is putting into this vision is for teacher training. And there are grassroots efforts, certainly in the UK and the US, to get more teachers trained to teach computer science. But I'm very optimistic. I'm optimistic for two reasons. One is I'm old enough to remember when I was called in to a summer program in upstate New York to teach math professors how to teach computer science. And now you don't need that anymore. The other reason I'm optimistic is that we are seeing skyrocketing enrollments in computer science in colleges in the US. I don't know what it's like in Austria and Europe in general, but the numbers are off the charts. There, in many universities, there are not enough classrooms large enough to hold all the students who want to take these courses. So they're turning students away, and they're turning majors, potential majors, away. So that is next generation. There are going to be, and then they may not even be majors, but they're going to be trained in some of these concepts, and maybe they will take these concepts and teach their colleagues on the job. So if you look at the next generation, and where the interest is, I'm pretty optimistic.
What do you think about the potential of MOOCs, these massive online courses like Coursera, Udacity, Khan Academy?
Yeah, that's actually one very good way to help solve the teacher training problem. And it's certainly a way to help me spread my vision of making computational thinking commonplace. In general, I think MOOCs are still a phenomenon to follow. I think there's the different companies are still figuring out what their business model is, and what success means. I don't think it's necessary to. So many students sign up to take these courses, but many don't finish the courses. Maybe that's okay. I think the world of MOOCs is still we're still in exploratory phase, both in terms of what they are and what they provide and what audiences they target, but also how they will affect and enhance normal education, like sitting in the classroom, hearing lectures, having recitations, having tutorials, working with real people face to face. So, yes.
One example you brought on the deep neural networking was there are ideas of automatically finding solutions which are patentable. And I would think that anyone who would like to do that has deep economic interests. So what I would ask you is what you think about this one side, the economy, and on the other side, the idea of computational thinking on proliferation of the people who can think in this way you explained. On the other side, the companies who want to sell their stuff and to make people only see what they produce.
I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I think you're asking a question about perhaps more generally, techniques in AI, like machine learning, that are becoming more prevalent in their use in industry, whether it's for recommending what movie you should watch, or collecting data about you so it can personalize the ads that you see on a web page. All of those AI machine learning techniques that are becoming more pervasive in our daily lives without our even realizing it, potentially doing more menial tasks that could possibly take over what people do today. Is that partly where your question is?
Yes, but also the products like a computer. I hear from a company who wants to sell everyone some kind of operating system and some kind of laptop or tablet or whatever. And you don't like to see that other companies do the same thing. So you take over and you go into the schools and bring them the goodies, and you don't want them to look at other goodies. To put it plain, I think it is much complex what I want to say, but to put it in that simple way.
Okay, I get what you're saying. You know, companies have competitors, and they are always, you know, within mind, watching their bottom line and trying to outbeat their competitors. Absolutely, I'm not going to argue that point. But the other way to think about it is, when there's competition, there's innovation, and when there's innovation, I like to think that benefits society. So you may not buy that argument, but this has been shown time and time again, not just in the IT industry, but in other industries.
Yeah, but you close out the people for knowledge. This is ultimately the thing. This was the open source movement. It's something which wanted to go against that.
But actually, if you're specifically picking on Microsoft now, Microsoft has actually embraced open source in a big way. And we also have admitted that our products and services need to work on multiple platforms, iOS, Android, you name it. And so it's a very different Microsoft from 2-3 years ago, believe me. And I think it is about being more open, and it is about being competitive.
Okay. Please speak in the microphones if you have a question, because we are recording this.
I have a question. Could you integrate computational thinking in the curriculum at the CMU?
Well, computational thinking, at Carnegie Mellon University, we actually revamped our entire computer science, sequence of computer science courses, especially in years one and two. And what we did specifically in year one, for both majors and non-majors, was to incorporate computational thinking. So, there you are. So we used to have an introduction to computing course for non-majors, and it was just as I was lamenting before, it was introduction to, you know, your favorite programming language of the day. So at one time it was C++, and then it was introduction to Java, and now it's really introduction to concepts in computer science. And we still use a programming language to teach those concepts. We use Python. And that course is for non-majors. And at Carnegie Mellon, what's interesting is that every student at Carnegie Mellon University is required to take a computing course, no matter what your major is. The only students waived from this requirement are the drama majors. So I'm not kidding. The art majors, English majors, you know, French majors, you have to take a computing course, and this is the course that we designed for them. It turned out that that course was a little too easy for engineering and computer science students, so we had a more advanced version of it. And that was just first semester, first year. And then we revamped our own computer science sequence for the majors, again, to emphasize computational thinking. So all these courses have curricula online. You can go look at them and see what is covered. Look at the problem sets, look at the projects.
Okay, let's take a final question.
Okay.
Please.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting. I understand that you promote computational thinking, but I ask you, have you always spent some thought about the disadvantages of it? Because I think there are a lot of disadvantages also, because, that you understand my question, I'm a technician and a jurist. And from the juridical point, I see a lot of disadvantages about computational
Wait,
thinking.
Wait, as a what and a what? As a lawyer?
A jurist, a lawyer. Not a lawyer, a jurist. I'm not a lawyer. This is a different. But I see a lot of disadvantages. I have also read a lot of things about this. And from this point of view, I ask you, have you spent some thoughts about the disadvantages of computational thinking?
Let me answer this question. It may not be exactly what you asked me, but as a computer scientist, I have thought about the implications of our technology on society and on humanity and on privacy, on ethics. And so as a computer scientist, I think deeply about those kinds of issues, because I think as any scientist, we are responsible for looking at the ethical and social implications of our technology. I think that is part of being a scientist. Now, I, you know, don't separate that from, you know, computational thinking. Computational thinking really is the concepts of computer science, but I don't think that there are bad implications in using computational thinking in specific to computational thinking as different from simply being a computer scientist and thinking about technology. So I hope that helps you at least understand my frame of mind. Yeah.
Actually, there is a final question.
Okay,
here.
One final question. I would like to know about high school level. So you said that computational thinking should be part of every children's general knowledge, part of the knowledge of the children, of the students. So do you agree like that computational thinking should be integrated in every subject, like for example in history? And do you have any example where you know in, for example, say, history classes, computational thinking was applied and integrated into the lessons?
That's a great question. You're asking, in some sense, you're asking a how are we going to execute to achieve this vision? There are two obvious ways. One is to have a separate course called computer science that you take or you offer every high school student. And that's a nice, easy way to do it. One problem with that is that there's often no room in the curriculum. Students are already jam-packed with taking math and biology and chemistry and physics and language and history and so on and so forth, and there's just no room. You can make it an elective, of course. The other is interesting, which is forget having a separate course, or in addition to having a separate course, you can add a little computational thinking to all these existing courses, whether it's history or English or art or chemistry or biology. I haven't seen that many efforts along that line at the high school level, partly because it means now teaching the biology teacher computing so that the biology teacher can integrate computing into teaching biology and teaching the history teacher, et cetera, right? So that's a lot more effort. I do know that there are such efforts, and they're nascent efforts, and I don't know how successful they are. For computational thinking at the high school level or the school K through 12 level, it's really all in, quote, I'd say, experimental exploratory phase right now. And, you know, we could do nothing or we could do something. And right now, we're doing something. And we, just like, I don't know what it's like in Austria, but in the United States, we have what are called math wars. Every few years, the math teachers are told, you need to teach math this way, not the way you used to teach it. And they all like unlearn how they used to teach math and learn this new way of teaching math. And the poor students are the ones who suffer, actually. So we think, I thought we knew how to teach mathematics to K through 12 students, but even the mathematicians have arguments about, or math educators have arguments about teaching math. So we're not even at that point where we can have computer science wars. We first need to get something out there, and then we can start learning from our experimentation and figuring out how best to teach computer science. I think the other analogy I like to make is physics, and it was certainly in the US after Sputnik that teaching physics at the high school level became so important. And the physics community created physics education as a research, a topic of research, how to teach physics, and how to, again, sequence the concepts that reflect the mathematical sophistication you need to understand these concepts. So that was, you know, happening decades ago, and now physics, there's a method to teaching physics to high school students and then to college age students. So, you know, these other fields have been around a lot longer than computer science. They have a head start on us. We're just beginning. So I would say we need to be patient. We need to be open-minded. We need to be experimental. We need to try things out and learn from our mistakes.
Okay, I think this is a very nice conclusion. I think you have given us a lot of food for thought, I think on many levels. I also hope that your very clear message is also received here in Austria. We are sometimes a bit behind, people say, so I hope we can catch up and in the high school curriculum, computer science is not confused with learning excellent words. Thank you very much for your presentation, and it was really great having you here. Thank you.